want to buy your shoes and socks, and a little bit more. I want to buy a house and lot, and a little bit more. I want to raise a family, children three or four. I want to give you everything you want, and a little bit, and a little bit, and a little bit more.
Athelia Sears Tanner was born on September 12, 1920, in Bountiful, Utah. Her parents, William Gailey Sears and Athelia Viola Call Sears, had wanted a big family, but it came with a price. William Gailey Sears and his first wife, whom we called Aunt Aggie, were very disappointed when they weren't able to have children. Finally, after about 10 years, they talked about taking another wife. In order to do that, of course, they had to go somewhere where polygamy was legal. So the two of them went to Colonial Dublon, Mexico, specifically to find a second wife. During the Cinco de Mayo celebration, they met a beautiful 16-year-old young woman named Athelia Viola Call. She was a candidate for being the Queen of the May, which would be like being the homecoming queen or the Rose Parade queen. William Gailey Sears took her hand to wish her luck, and Athelia recorded that when she felt his hand, an electric shock went through her. That later felt like a confirmation of the spirit to her that she was supposed to marry William Gailey Sears. Athelia was a beautiful young woman with luscious chestnut hair. There was no reason for her to have to marry an older man. She had plenty of boys who were crazy about her. But she chose to marry Grandpa in polygamy. Her union to William Gailey Sears and Aunt Aggie was a very happy one. She also talked about how much she and Aunt Aggie loved each other and how they were truly sister wives, kind and considerate and supportive of each other in every way. Because William Gailey Sears and Athelia Call were married after the Manifesto of 1890, when the Mormon Church officially abandoned plural marriage, there's no wedding certificate. Nevertheless, Athelia bore many children to William. And Aggie and William considered these children theirs and always referred to them as their children, as did Athelia. They had Agnes, Joe, Thressa, Marguerite, Viola, Verda, and then our mother, Athelia. A younger sister, Sarah Jane, was born after Mom, but she lived only a month and died of meningitis. And then 4 years later, they had another little boy whom they named Bill, William Gailey Sears. And finally, the last child came, Lucille, 9 years younger than my mother.
And then Verda, and then me. And then what do you want to know? After me, what did you really want to know? Didn't really want to know anything after me, did you?
They were married in Juarez, Mexico, and they did move to Salt Lake for a while and then moved back to Douglas, Arizona, just over the border from Mexico, and lived there until Athelia was 4 years old.
I remember living in Douglas, Arizona. I'd be in Douglas, Arizona, but if I'd go across the street, I'd be in Mexico. So if they wanted me to do something, they'd just have me go across the street, and I'd be in a different country. And
there was always so much work to be done at home. So Athelia and her other sisters invented ways to make the work more fun.
We used to sing together, we'd harmonize. And make up songs, medley, what we call medleys, where we'd go from one song to another, to another, to another.
We sang when we did everything. That was just,
I can't even remember ever doing dishes, sweeping, cleaning the house, anything without singing. I really can't. That was just what we did.
Arizona was the home of the U.S. military base, and the presence of all these young soldiers was often a source of concern for Grandpa and Grandma.
But they were nice to me. I don't know why. I don't know how I got away with things, but I did.
When Bill and Athelia decided to move from Arizona back to Utah, it turned out that they would be leaving the day before Athelia turned 5 years old. So she was thrilled to be able to ride on the train with her father because she didn't have to pay any money. And because Mom was a precocious child, she still remembers making friends with all the passengers on that train ride.
I made friends with everyone on the train, and I thought they wanted to be around me. I wanted to be around them.
The main reason why Athelia and Bill had decided to move back to Salt Lake for the second time was because they were being ridiculed a lot by some of the military men. Some of Mother's older sisters had been spending a lot of time with both boyfriends and girlfriends that did not keep church standards, and that was very troubling to the parents. But the family was told always, never lie about the fact that we live in polygamy, but you don't need to tell everyone either. So there was a certain amount of secrecy in just trying to keep a very low profile. They moved into a house at 1164 Bueno Ave and lived there until they moved into 756 East 200 South. This was important because it was right next door to the beautiful Sears home where William, Athelia's husband, had grown up. And their first wife, Aggie, had a chance to live in a separate room in a separate house right next door. Mom went to the second grade at Wasatch School. She loved schoolwork and never got anything but an A. In fact, she was so used to getting the answers right that one day the teacher said, "Athelia, what would you say is the answer?" And she got it wrong, and the teacher said, "Well, if you said that, you would be wrong." And Mother was humiliated.
I went to Irving Junior High. That's right, I went to Irving Junior High. And then I went to what they call South High School.
Mother used to have to go with her older sister, who took the trolley to work, and then bring the ticket back so that her father could use the same unlimited ticket when he went to work. And one day the trolley broke down and was late, making Mother lose her perfect punctuality record for the school year, and it broke her heart.
We'd call it working the pass because, you know, I could go and go for free. Oh, you get these tokens that were 3 for a quarter or something like that. But I used to walk home a lot of time. At midnight, isn't that terrible? Because I wanted to save the money. Because we just didn't have any money.
Her father was called to be the mission president in Samoa for the second time. He took his first wife, Aunt Aggie, with him and left my grandmother, Athelia Viola Call Sears, home with all of the children. It was a very difficult time for the family because although Grandpa sent money home as much as he could, as you know, mission presidents don't make much money, and they especially didn't then. So Mom's older sisters really supported the family.
Young Athelia got used to having her father gone. So when he came back from Samoa, she and the family had been fending for themselves for quite some time. Since her father was very authoritarian and a bit of a chauvinist, it was a little bit hard for our mom to have him come home and see his wives wait on him hand and foot. One of Mom's most unpleasant childhood memories was when she was sent to the store to get some sugar right before school.
And it was hot, and I was carrying it home. And, you know, it was hot. And this sack of sugar broke, and there was all of our sugar. And And then Mother made me go scrape it up. So humiliating. It was terrible. And my name was Mud when that happened. It doesn't sound like anything to you now because you've lived in a day of affluence.
Mom went to junior high at Irvin Junior High School, and she was very popular. So was a young man named Bill Tanner, who was actually president of the student body there, as well as president of the student body at this high school that they went to.
Always, wherever we went, he was student body president. He just was a real leader, you know.
Dad claims that he fell in love with Mom the first time he saw her in her little gym outfit. During high school and college, Mom was very athletic, and in days when it wasn't so popular for women to be athletes, in today's world, she would have been a great gymnast.
And I used to stand on my head and walk on my head and do back flips and all that kind of stuff. Would you like me to do it for you right now?
Because even at 95, she could stretch out on the floor, hold her arms on out straight, and touch each toe to the opposite hand. Mom fell in love with Dad and knew that he had a paper route, so she made sure that she walked past the corner where his papers were delivered for him to fold.
I'd help him fold them. I would pass them out and throw them on people's porches.
Both of them went to the University of Utah, but Dad went a year earlier than Mom because he opted to skip his senior year and just go right on to college. Mom stayed in high school and finished, and then went on to University of Utah as well, where she served as the student body secretary, was in charge of all of the women's athletic program for the students.
She and her friends, including Barbara Smith, who later became general president of the Relief Society, started a sorority called Agalia Mu. It was focused on learning and on service rather than drinking and partying, as other sororities were.
Dad came home from his mission in November of 1941, and Mom, who was dating many other people at the time, thought, I bet Bill's about ready to come home, and gave him a phone call. Very unusual for Mom to ever call a young man. And she happened to catch him on the day he and his mom and dad were walking in the door from driving back from the Eastern States Mission where he had served, and Dad never let Mom live that down. But he was so in love that he proposed to Mom by saying, well, if we got married, we'd have to live with my folks. I don't have any money, and I couldn't buy you a ring. And Mom said, well, that'd be okay.
Depression times, and boy, there was just no money. Hard cash was really hard to come by.
So not very many months later, they were married on 14th of February, on Valentine's Day, very soon after my father had returned from his mission, and they were very poor.
My father was so impecunious, as he used to always claim, so poor that he didn't have enough money for anything, not for the ring, not for the wedding license. So Grandpa Tanner actually had to pay for both the wedding ring and the marriage license. And the newlyweds had to live with his parents after they were married.
She was sort of glad to have somebody that could do the cooking for a change. Oh, she was going to teach me how to pack pies, and I knew how to do that. Is that what you mean? But I had to, you know, let her think that I didn't know how.
My mom, however, did finish her university studies and graduated from the University of Utah. And when she graduated, she was already pregnant with their oldest child, Bobby, or Roberta Tanner. And we teased and teased Mom and Dad about her being born 9 months to the day after they were married.
Dad was a natural-born leader. He was the student body president of South High. He was also the student body president of his junior high school. And in his ROTC work, both in high school and in his University of Utah experience, he became an officer, so when he went into the service, he went in as an officer.
A year and a half later, little Athelia was born, named after my mother, in 1944, on the 1st of April. Dad was called up to be in the war in World War II as an officer, and he was sent to South Carolina for officer's training. He was by himself for a while, and then Mom and Bobby and Athelia and Aunt Lou went out to join him. Aunt Lou just went along so that Mom would have help with these two little toddler and baby.
North Carolina. Oh, yeah. That was a big thing in those days, you know, to go that far. But I did. I just had this nice outfit that I'd made. You know, I used to make everything. And it was all this long ride, and it was bad weather. They didn't know how to handle that too well, you know. And so I threw up all over the place. But anyway, and I didn't have another outfit to wear. It was terrible.
Choo-choo, the big train is coming down the track now. Choo-choo, the big train is coming down the track. Stop, look and listen. Stop, look and listen. Choo-choo, the big train is coming down the track.
When Dad came home from the service and World War II had been won, there was great celebrating all over the world, but Mom and Dad were thrilled to be back together again. My father graduated from University of Utah, and Mom and Dad moved to Minneapolis, Minnesota for Dad to finish a master's degree.
She got out to Minnesota, and she didn't have any of her clothes arrive, and she was pregnant. And so she was so embarrassed to have this, to have no clothes and to be pregnant and to and have a neighbor that was really mean to her.
The first two little girls were born before Dad went in the service, and Terry, the third child, was born right when Dad got home. You'll never know how many dreams I dream about you, or just how empty they all seem without you. Before Mom married, she had planned to go back to New York and be a dietitian in a hospital there. But instead, she had beautiful babies and was a great nutritionist for us all of her life.
Homemade bread, I'd make it all the time. Usually whole wheat. Oh yeah, white bread, but just a no-no.
And while there, my next brother, Trace, William Coates Tanner III was born on March 10, 1948. And they called him Trace because Mother said we already had lots of bills, the phone bill, the house bill, the insurance bills, the light bill, and we didn't need any more bills. Her father was named Bill, her husband was named Bill, her brother was named Bill. So they called him Trace because he was William Coates Tanner III. To save money, when my mother and father were in graduate school, part of the time they lived with my father's parents, Clara and Bill, in the beautiful brick home, which is the city sexton's home in Salt Lake City, Utah. We had great times playing on the tombstones that were in the backyard. And then they went back to University of Utah, before Dad worked for many more years getting his PhD in educational psychology.
My dad was the guide on Temple Square as a part-time job for a while. And he had served his mission in the Central States, so he was very enamored of church history. He loved church history. He loved the prophet and all of those early brethren in the church. And I loved to hear him bear his testimony about the church as he guided those tour groups around. It was kind of really a high for me. I just loved going with him. I was probably only about 7 or so.
And while Dad was still in graduate school, John Sears Tanner was born on the 27th of July, 1950. When Dad was trying to finish his dissertation, he came home one day and said, "Athelia, how would you like for me to teach seminary? I'm going to go teach seminary this coming year." She, of course, thought he meant early morning seminary. What Dad meant was that they were moving to Firth, Idaho. And while he was supposed to be compiling and collating all of this research that he had done, administering the MMPI test to hundreds of teachers all over Utah, very little of that got done. They lived in a basement house, and he did teach seminary, but it was all day long. And Mom was horrified to have Dad have to leave this very important work that they had tried for years for him to be completing. Even though Dad was earning a little salary, it wasn't much, and some of us older children remember going into the potato fields and gleaning potatoes, which is much of what we lived on. Fried potatoes, baked potatoes, boiled potatoes, potato soup, potato patties. We had lots of potatoes when we were living in Idaho.
Piggy wake and piggy wee, hungry pigs as big as could be, for their dinner had to wait down behind the barnyard gate. Piggy wig and piggy wee climbed the barnyard gate to see, but no dinner could they spy peeking o'er the gate so high. Piggy wig and piggy wee got down sad as pigs could be, but the gate soon opened wide and they scampered forth inside.
With Mom's encouragement, Dad decided to return to Salt Lake and finish his dissertation and defend it. And he finally graduated right after Richard was born on August 28, 1952.
He had beautiful curly blonde hair that Mom cried when we cut his hair, and she saved it in an envelope because he looked just like a Botticelli angel. He was so beautiful. So in 1953, my mom was chosen to be the sweetheart of Stadium Village, and partly because she had the most children of anyone there, but partly because she was so loving and kind. To help out with finances, she watched children in Stadium Village, which was a terrible little Quonset hut apartment, and boiling hot in the summer, freezing cold in the winter. It was after Richard was born that Dad finally got that PhD. He was so happy to get it, but he wasn't any happier than my sister Bobby, who put the cap on her head as just a little girl and said, "I've waited my whole life for this." When Dad finally received his PhD, he and Mom were thrilled that he got a job with Educational Testing Systems, ETS, and they moved to South Pasadena, California. As my dad was driving around, he saw a place that obviously needed yard work, and he stopped and knocked on the door and asked the owner of the home if they could rent part of the house and if he could use hard work and doing the yard and keeping the yard up to help him pay the rent. The lady who lived there was very kind to us, but the noise and confusion drove her crazy, and we only stayed there 1 year, and then they found another home to live in South Pasadena, 1015 Fremont Ave, right next to the post office. Turn the key on. You are equipped with taillight neon. You got a cute. And it was there that we had, Mom had the next baby, who was Mark, born on May 1st of 1954. After Mark was born, Claralyn was born 2 years later on May 7th, 1956, and then a year, a month, and a day later, beautiful little Kay was born. June 8th, 1957. So they almost were like little twins. We got a twin stroller for them, did their hair the same, and had matching outfits for them.
Oh, and I dress them alike, and people would say, "Are you twins?" And say, "No, we're a year, a month, and a day apart." They couldn't say they're odds.
Mom rarely got sick, but once when she was sick, the Relief Society came in and served her, and it was during that time that Look magazine did a great big feature article on compassionate service in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and Mom was the featured patient. Because Mom didn't have very much money, she learned to sew and learned to sew well, and she made matching outfits for us all the time.
I sewed for them all the time. I wonder now how I did all those things, you know. Got up very early in the morning, and I stayed up very late. That's how I got, how I was able to accomplish things, I guess.
Dakin was born on August 5th, 1959, and that made 10 children in the house at 1015 Fremont Street. Imagine trying to raise 10 children in a two-bedroom, one-and-a-half-bath house in today's world. Eventually, the three older girls were able to make the attic into a room for them.
That was when my dad started to think about success in big ways. He had only worked for Educational Testing Service for a year when he decided to start his own company. And this was a great blessing and a great curse to my mother and to all of us, because he knew nothing about business, literally nothing.
Dad had gotten a very good contract with a grocery store and had tested and counseled many, many of their employees, but he was worried. One day in talking to one of his best friends, Dakin Broadhead, who owned Capitol Records and other companies, he said, "Dakin, I'm really worried. We're not going to have a Christmas if we don't get paid, and I haven't been paid a cent." And Dakin said, "Well, Bill, when was the last time that you billed these people that you did the work for?" And Dad said, "Bill them? Oh my gosh, I didn't realize I had to bill them." So that was kind of how much he knew about running a business.
Dad decided we needed to move into a bigger, better home. We spent months driving all over South Pasadena, Alhambra, and San Marino looking at homes. But, of course, we couldn't afford it. However, through using his own techniques that he taught people, he was able to talk the owner of 1133 Buena Vista into selling us a beautiful mansion, 36 rooms, 6 bathrooms, hardwood floors, sterling silver sinks in the butler's pantry, 4 floors of gorgeous house at a price we could afford. One of the most wonderful traditions that we had, however, involved other people, and that occurred after we moved into Tanner Manor because we had plenty of room and a little bit more money. And somehow Mom and Dad always managed a budget to host everyone in the neighborhood and in the ward, in the whole city of South Pasadena. Especially those people who never were invited out for anything. And they had them for dinner, and then our family always put on a program. And part of the program was singing the 12 Days of Christmas with each of the children and their mates and their children acting out one of the verses of the 12 Days of Christmas.
They always do the 12 Days of Christmas, and they have these little actions with it, partridge in a pear tree, 2 turtle doves, and we all have to do these little actions with it. My dad was always, he would say a peacock in a plum tree. I mean, he'd always mess it up. Everyone telling you be of good cheer,
it's the most. And we had wonderful traditions. One of them was that we always came down the stairs, oldest by oldest, singing jingle bells.
at the Christmas dinner and party that my mother always had our family give to the neighbors and ward members who didn't get invited anywhere, we also sang as a family and did lots of entertaining. One of our favorite songs to sing was Have a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, have a Merry Christmas. We're so glad that you could be with us today. We deck the halls with holly, so let's all be jolly. We hope to make your Christmas season bright and gay. So while you chant or sing now, make the rafters ring now. Everybody sing it loud and clear. Sing it out, Tanners. Just give a great big shout, Tanners. Merry Christmas and a glad. Merry Christmas and a glad. Merry Christmas and a glad New Year. We were hams, were we? We had so much fun, though. We really did.
Christmas was really a big deal at our family. We had lots of homemade things because, especially as Mom and Dad were starting out their marriage, we would string popcorn, 5 pieces of popcorn and a piece of cranberry, and 5 pieces of popcorn and a cranberry to put on the tree. We also made popcorn balls and wrapped them in colored cellophane because those would not break like ornaments would break when the tree got knocked over, which it always did by whoever the resident toddler was. Much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. We had lots of fun times going to all of the neighbors and all of the friends in our ward and taking homemade banana nut bread and homemade fruit breads, as well as our famous Christmas coffee cake rings.
We would go to the old people's homes and sing to them because they never got it. And they'd just wait for us. They'd be so thrilled to have somebody care enough to come and sing to them.
My mom had a very tender heart for things like music and literature and art. And I think I got that love for those things from her. And we used to often sing musicals together. We'd sing the songs and would talk about books and ideas. But I remember once we even sang in public, which I never do. We sang, c'est moi, I'm forced to admit. I'm far too noble to lie. The man in whom these qualities bloom, c'est moi, tes I. And she got such a kick out of these things because there's one line in there that said, I'm blessed with an iron will. Had I been made the partner of Eve, would be in Eden still. And she would just, she loved that line.
She was always giving, always doing service, always very organized.
Mother was a dedicated and very effective Relief Society teacher. She studied and knew the material and the doctrines well. And she was very motivating to the people in her class. She did that calling for several years, and everyone loved her. Then she was released, and a Sister Nielsen was the new Relief Society teacher. And guess what? She was also an excellent teacher. She gave a great lesson, and various sisters came up and told her how motivated they were to be better people, and exactly like my mother. Well, I think Mother was a little bit threatened by that. My mother could have chosen to do a number of things, backbite, criticize, in even a subtle way. What she chose to do was make a big pan of hot rolls, take them over to Sister Nielsen and tell her that I know that you're busier now than ever, that you're preparing these wonderful lessons. I really enjoyed your lessons, and here are some hot rolls for your family so you can have more time.
On October 18th, 1960, Scott Sears Tanner was born.
Mom came from a very loving family, and she and Dad purposely created a very loving family.
And you know, and I remember that when you had friends that their brothers and sisters didn't like each other, they'd want to get away from them. And ours were just the opposite. They loved to be together. I think I did a pretty good job with you kids, because you're all good kids, and you all love each other, don't you? And people are surprised at that. They can't believe that brothers and sisters can really love each other. And they're always surprised, you know, when they find that out. And I think, oh, of course. Don't you? You better.
There's a queer little man living under the hill, and his name is Leapfrog John. Oh, he'd have said misfortune and works with a will, and he's honest as the rising sun. Though he's out of the elbow and lame in the knee, and he talks through his red bug nose, yet he's merry and joyous and happy as can be, as a limping on his way he goes. Leapfrog John, Leapfrog John, Leapfrog is his name. Oh, the funniest man in all the world is merry little Leapfrog John.
Later on August 5th, 1962, our final little sister was born, Janet Tanner. Brian Sears Tanner, last the best of all the game, our youngest brother, was born on March 19th, 1964. We think maybe it was because Mom couldn't nurse that Brian was so colicky, but he was in a lot of pain and cried incessantly. It was really hard on all of us, but Mom was ever patient and loving.
The last one, and he just cried and cried and cried. He was just terrible. He was just terrible. If I'd have had him first, I would have had a big family. He was a pill.
Living in this gorgeous mansion was a double-sided sword for my mom, because although we lived in a house that made us look rich, she never had any money. And one time the paper boy had to come back three different times. And she said, "I'm sorry, I don't have the money." He said, "Oh, come on, lady. Nobody lives in a house like this and can't come up with $11.15. And Mom said, "I'm so sorry, I don't have the money. I'll get it and have it for you next time."
We never had money. And I remember we'd have family prayers and he'd say, "Well, we need $200,000, and as a little kid, that was upsetting to me. I didn't know how I was supposed to do that.
Dad was a great dreamer, and although his classes had solid principles and very good techniques, which if followed, could bring great happiness and success, he had a very difficult time making his work into a business. And as a dreamer, he involved all of us in his dream. At one point, he would have us all marching around the house, chanting, "We're going to make our million, we're going to make our million." It was feast or famine, mostly famine, as we were all growing up.
He always wanted to be famous, and he wanted to be rich, and he wanted to do well in the church. And I don't think he ever became famous. I know he didn't become rich. But he was an unforgettable kind of character. People always remembered Bill Tanner.
You know, he'd always say, "Well, we can't afford you guys, but we had you anyway. You just lived on faith." And I just felt like that was pretty wonderful. I mean, but I never felt poor. I never felt poor, even though we probably were really poor. I never felt like, "Oh, we're so poor." And
for many of those years, we did not have a washer or a dryer. And Mom, having as many children as she did, had a lot of wash. So once a week, she would go to the laundromat and she would take almost every washer.
22 loads of laundry twice a week, every Wednesday and Saturday, sort of commandeering those things. But when you think about it, my mom was always doing laundry, always cleaning, always cooking. It was really kind of remarkable.
At one point in my life, they had me take all the wash and drop it off at the laundromat on the way to seminary, and I would fill every washer, start up everything, separate the whites from the colors, and start everything up, and then on the way home from seminary, we would put them into the dryer. Happy ending to this story is that someone who really loved Mom and Dad anonymously sent them a washer and dryer for Christmas one year. We had a knock on the back door, and when Mom answered it, they said, "Mrs. Tanner, we have a new washer and dryer for you." And she said, "Oh, I'm sorry. We didn't order a washer and dryer." And they said, "We know. This is a gift from someone who doesn't want to be known.
The tradition which Mom had started as a child of harmonizing with and singing with her family, she passed on to our family. And we sang and did actions to dozens of different songs.
We had fun together. We sang. We sang for everything.
Mother usually had written the lyrics too.
Mom was frequently asked how on earth she was able to do all the work that was required by a family that big. And she would always say,
"But I was very healthy. I'm still very healthy. And I expect others to work. Because I worked. You know, I didn't sit around and just boss them. I'd do it with them so that if they had a job to do, they knew they had to do it."
My parents both had, you know, chores in the morning, chores in the afternoon after school, chores at night. They had everything so organized that it was very easy for me then, as a parent, to know how to do things with my children.
I had lists, and I planned according to their ages and everything, so that every single one of them had something they had to do every day, and feel that they'd accomplished it and completed it. And I'd check on them to see if they had, and I'd, you know, make sure that they had.
She had lots of lists. Some people call her the lady with lists, because in a big family, you get a lot of people to help. That's how people say, "Well, how do you do it?" Well, when there's older kids, they start to do it. So when I was growing up, I sometimes helped make breakfast or make lunches.
They all had to help. They all had special little things they had to do. And they felt, I mean, that I couldn't get along without them, you know, doing this little thing or this little thing or this little thing. So they always really felt special, that they were specially needed.
Mom had her pet peeves. One of them she learned from Dad, and it had to do with people saying, "Have a good day."
We always say, "Make it a good day." If anyone says, "Have a good day," it's almost like swearing, isn't it? If anyone says that, it's like, "Make it a good day." If it's not a good day, you can make it that way, right?
Mother was a great storyteller. Most of her stories had moral messages, and she told us stories about Lamanites and Nephites until she had us playing those instead of playing cowboys and Indians.
I was totally into sports in junior high and high school, and that was what I lived for. And I remember I had to get my Eagle Scout award. And I was more interested in sports than doing the Eagle Scout. My mom said, "You need to do your Eagle Scout, and I will support you once you do that." So after the whole Eagle Scout project was done and all the merit badges were earned, I was in the council, the interview, with my mom, with all the silver beavers of the world that were the Joe Scouters, and they said, "Now, Sister Tanner, we want to make sure that you encourage Brian to continue on in scouting." And she said, "No." I told him that if he got his Eagle, he could do all the sports he wanted. And at that moment, my mom became a hero to me, because she stood up for what she told me she was going to do. It would have been very easy for her to tell the priesthood leaders at the time, "You know what, yeah, I'll encourage him," but she didn't, and I loved her for that.
All 13 children graduated from the same schools, El Centro Elementary School, where we gathered to ring the bell, South Pasadena Junior High and South Pasadena High School.
and we were very achievement oriented. Almost everybody was a student body officer. Most of us played sports of some kind. Many of us were in drama productions, and so, you know, it was nice to come home. It wasn't a place that we dreaded. It was a nice place to be.
The very first wedding that Mom had and Dad of their children was a double wedding. Bobby and Ray and Athelia and Ken both got married on the same day in the Los Angeles Temple.
You are my candy girl, and you got me wanting you.
Mom worked so hard to prepare for the reception, which was at our home in Tanner Manor. And Mom went to tons of work to get everything spotless and to get it decorated a little bit. She organized many, many friends of hers, some of them members of the ward, to help with this project, which was a thing Mom did very well. Then just 15 months later, I married Jim Mitchell. And Mom was in love with Jim before I was, at least she was always telling me not to just fluff him off. And we also got married in the Los Angeles Temple, but we had our reception at another home, sparing her all the work of having that reception in our home.
Mom was marvelous at baking and made fabulous homemade rolls and pies. Nobody could make better pies than my mom, and nobody could make better rolls than my mom.
I can make good pie crust. A lot of people can't, they don't put enough shortening in. And so their pie crusts are tough. But I make good pie crust.
People love being around my dad. My dad was a fairly short man, slightly shorter than I am, but strong upper shoulder muscles. And he did this thing called the airplane, and he would just kind of catch people off guard and say, especially to girls, well, do you want the airplane? And they said, no, what's that about? And hardly before they could finish answering, he would go over and pick them up and put them on his shoulder and spin around so that they were basically like a propeller spinning around.
I think he liked the attention that would come to him as he would shock people, but he was always inviting people to his funeral, you know, complete strangers. He was always asking them if they knew what the word impecunious meant, which means without funds, but he'd do it with a laugh.
I appreciated that they let us be noisy and loud and crazy. Some of my favorite memories were taking a baby mattress and sliding down this wooden set of stairs from the attic to the third floor. And I was telling my friend one time about how much fun we had getting thick sleeping bags or that baby mattress. Just for hours we'd do that. And she said, well, where were your parents? You know, what were they saying? And I said, I think my mom maybe called out to us once in a while. And that's when the picture came into clear view for me. That was my parents saying, it's okay to live and to be exuberant and have fun and enjoy this house that we've been blessed with.
On occasion, Mom would be asked if she really wanted to have that many children. She never hesitated to say yes.
So we all knew we were wanted. There's never a doubt in our mind that any of us was an accident. I remember one joke one time, someone said, well, your parents don't have a TV around, or something like that.
I wanted every single one of them, and they knew that. There wasn't one of them I didn't want.
Thank you.
You know, I would feel terrible when people would say, well, we really didn't expect this one, but, you know, we love them now, but we didn't want them, you know, we didn't. And I'd say, you don't need to say that in front of them, you know.
We all had to work our way through college because Dad insisted that we all be college graduates and wanted us to have graduate degrees. But none of us ever got a nickel from Mom and Dad to go to school. My father loved to tell everyone that Mom was much smarter than he was, and she was. She had a very high IQ, and because he was a psychologist, he tested everyone and knew all of our IQs. He was sensitive about it, but he still broadcast it to everyone who would listen.
Now, my father, by training, by profession, was a psychologist. But in many ways, my mom was, in her own right, an incredible psychologist. You know, here again, I'm the 11th of 13 children. I'm one of many. But she had this way of making me feel special. For example, I remember I was kind of messy as a young child. I wasn't always good at cleaning my room and things like that. My mom had done the wash, and she put the clothes in my room. She probably folded them as well. And I remember I must have put them away in my drawer. So my socks and my underwear or whatever, I put them in my top drawer, all nice and neat. And my mom, like, found out that I had done that. And she was like, oh, Scott, you are so neat. You put your clothes away. I just love how neat you are. Now, it's probably the first time I ever did it. But you know for sure after that, I always wanted to do it because that became part of my identity. So she reinforced for me the positive things.
Well, my dad was one of a kind. He just had very strong views. He used to call leaders people with firm, fixed ideas, some of which are false.
I remember we never saw The Wizard of Oz because it was on Sunday, and it was almost very close to being a mortal sin to turn the television on Sunday. I do remember the day that the astronauts landed on the moon. My parents were having a small gathering with a fireside over at our house, and there was a big debate as to whether they were going to turn on the television and watch Neil Armstrong land on the moon. They finally did. We had an awful television, so it was so grainy.
My dad was very black and white. He taught us right and wrong, and he taught us that we could choose. He always encouraged that, always. One time I went to church, one time I didn't go to church, and I said, I don't want to go to church today. And he said, well, you know how I feel about that. I'm disappointed in you, but it's your choice. So I stayed home, and I was miserable. I never did that again. But he allowed us to grow that way.
You know, I think for the most part, our parents wanted us to be good, and they tried to be good to us. I think my 20/20 hindsight says they were doing the best that they could with what they knew and what they had.
When I was in elementary school, I was quite an active young kid. And I remember one occasion, my sister and I, Terry, among other things, we were in our rambling around, we had climbed up on the roof, a garage roof of somebody's house. It wasn't our own house, but it was right there behind our home. And we were just playing around. And there was a man in the neighborhood, and we used to call him Mr. Crabapple. And he was a busybody. And he was down at the in the alleyway, and he'd shake his finger up at us, and he'd be saying, I'm gonna go tell your daddy on you. Look at what you're doing, you're such a bad person. Well, my father came out, and right in our presence, because we were up on the roof, kind of worried about what was going to happen, basically scolded this man for just being a busybody, worrying about kids, having a good time. And he said, just, I'll take care of my own kids, thank you. Don't worry about them. I'll be responsible for them. Why don't you go find something else better to do with your time?
Press, press, press. All the milk must be from the golden butter now pressed out carefully. Pat, 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 make it smooth and mound. Now my golden butter's done, won't you buy a pound?
Thank you.
With children getting married, the grandchildren started coming. It didn't take long till our family was overflowing with little ones.
And they're all good friends still. And they're all active still. So that's great, isn't it?
Mom taught us to love each other, and her huge priority, without question, was that we love God first and love each other second and serve each other willingly. And Mom always said, just look for what needs to be done and do it without being asked.
When I was raising my own children, I had difficult children, some. And I said to my mother, Mother, did you have any hard children? And she looked at me with sort of a funny look and said, yes, you. And so I remembered when I was little, I was acting up, and I think my mother must have had it way past here. And she devised this little sign, and neither one of us can remember what it is. That it was some sign that she could make or I could make that would let the other person know that we were really frustrated and be careful, so that we wouldn't always be arguing and she wouldn't have to probably yell at me or whatever, because I was a difficult child.
I was a black sheep, which I guess that wasn't what one would aspire to be, but that's what he called me, was his black sheep. I was the first child who didn't go to BYU. I went to Stanford, and
I'm clearly the black sheep in the family. I got divorced, and that didn't happen in the Tanner family. And there was a good reason for it, and I think finally people came to accept the fact and accept my wife, and they knew it was the best thing. But when that happened, that was hard. Some of them have a harder time than that with others, but at least I'm loved by them all, and I think. But I know that I'm much less in the really straight arrow kind of mold that a number of them really are.
And the grasshopper said, you're laughing at me and I won't play anymore. So off he went, though he wanted to stay, for he was not hurt by his fall. And the gay little cricket just went on with her game, and they never missed him at all. Said a wise old owl, looking from above down below, what a foolish little fellow that grasshopper was. Why, he nipped off his own little nose.
Dad had wanted 12 tribes of Tanner, and he was very adamant that he wanted 100 grandchildren. So he was actually disappointed when they only had 78. As loving as Dad was, we suspected that he didn't know all of their names. He used to always say, now what's your name? And everyone would laugh, but we were pretty sure that he didn't know who they were. Mom, however, knew everyone's name, and she knew everyone's birthday.
I think one of the gifts that she had with a family this large is the gift of making every child feel special. In some ways, she had the gift like the Savior did with the woman who had an issue of blood and in the crowd. He somehow felt the need of one person among a multitude. And I think she made each child feel special that way.
On one occasion, my father ran for school board, which was an elected position in the city of South Pasadena. And it was an intense, very close race. In fact, I remember that he lost that election by 17 votes. And he was fine with that. He ran because he wanted to be a public servant, and he felt like he had something to offer, but he wasn't heartbroken that he didn't get it. I remember after the election, for some reason, because this was very unusual in our family, my father took me to lunch. And we went to a place called the House of Pies in South Pasadena on Fair Oaks. But I remember Les Bach coming by. He must have eaten at a different table or something, or was just coming in. And Les Bach was on the city council. He lived a few blocks from our house, was friends with our parents, and a politician. But I remember he stopped to talk to my dad about the election. And Les was a great man. But in essence, what he said was, "Bill, you lost that election because you were too honest. You were too open about your membership in your church. There's no reason you need to share your feelings about your church and some of your strong opinions. You still can do those things. Had you been elected, you still would have been able to implement that. And that was your objective, was to get on the school board so you could make a difference." And I'll never forget, my dad said, "Les, it's not worth it to me to be anything less than honest. It's not worth winning an election or being on the school board or anything else." That's the kind of thing that rings in your ears when you're older and you're in business and you get in positions when it would be easy to compromise your beliefs or your statements or how you portray things for your advantage or for your company's advantage.
As Grandma Tanner, Clara Sutton Tanner, got older and had been living in Salt Lake for a long time, our family brought her down to live with us in Southern California. Mom was very wise in the way that she interacted with Grandma, and Grandma boasted all the time to us and any friends that came by that they had never had an unkind word, and they didn't. A lot of it was due to my mother's patience and goodness. She was very careful in making sure that Grandma got special treatment and that she had a little job to do. Mom would always let Grandma be the one to sort the socks. And you can imagine how many socks needed to be sorted and sometimes darned for a family with 12 children at home still.
I learned so much about my mother on a trip that we took to Mexico. I was surprised by this because we were taking a trip to Mexico to learn about her mother, Athelia Viola Call Sears Irvine. But instead, I learned more about my mother. Her mother grew up in Mexico as a polygamist daughter. And there she married my grandfather, and then my mother became a polygamist daughter. She has a certain sensitivity about her and a kindness and an awareness about her because of her upbringing. She's a champion for the underdog. She always would invite people over to our home, but not just the presidents of the company and not just the bishopric and the stake president and so forth. She would invite the janitors over, and she would invite their families, and she would invite a large Hispanic populace in our ward. She was kind to everybody, and she taught us that too.
They were never happier than when they were building the kingdom together, and they spent thousands of hours teaching the gospel, not just to their 13 children and their 78 grandchildren, but to everyone who entered the house. When they weren't teaching specifically, as my dad was wont to do, they were teaching by example.
My husband always used to say when the church called my dad to be a mission president, they really got two for one, because my mom was an equally good missionary to my dad. And she actually did a lot of the work. She was one of the implementers of a lot of things that he started. And so while he would be interviewing missionaries on a regular basis, once every month or so, my mom would take the companions and teach them how to, she would role play with them how to talk to somebody on the bus or in the grocery store or whatever to introduce the gospel to them. And so she was a very important part of the one-on-one with the missionaries, teaching them that.
My dad visualized for us for 20 years. He did say, I don't know which one is going to be married last, Janet or Brian, but whoever gets married last, we all have to be together with our mates in the temple. Everyone has to be there. So when Brian fell in love at BYU and wanted to marry Renee Bake, all of us had to go to Chicago where my parents were serving as mission presidents. The mountain came to Mohammed.
During that memorable ceremony in the Chicago Temple, the sealer commented how impressed he was that all 13 Tanners and their mates were there. There would be no empty chairs.
That was our sort of little theme. No empty chairs. They all came. We had a good family. In case you haven't caught this, they really love each other.
And of course, God himself has a great sense of humor, because we can't get that many Tanners together without a major catastrophe.
So the night after the reception, there's a huge downpour, and we don't think much about it, but all of a sudden, when we wake up, there is a huge flood on the floor. And I had a child on the floor sleeping. Everybody's picking up some of their babies off the floor, and we're just panicking a little bit because, you know, what if our kid is suffocating or drowning? Who knows what was going on? I just was crazy, but worth it. It was my dad's dream. He had told us from day one, my dream is to have all 13 of you be there at Brian's wedding.
He walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joys we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Even as adults, Mom stayed close to her siblings all of her life and was best friends with her sisters and then younger brother especially.
I will always remember repeatedly sitting on the second row, the second pew in our chapel, and having testimony meetings. And in our testimony meetings, they would pass a microphone instead of having people going up to the podium. Many times I remember my mom getting up, and because it was up toward the front, she would stand and turn around, kind of sit on the bench, the top of the bench behind her a little bit, and just bear a beautiful, sweet testimony of Jesus Christ.
Certain things that she would talk about, how people abused the Savior, whether that was spitting on him, helping us recognize the actual atonement, the crucifixion, the things that he went through that pierced our souls as well, when she would bear her testimony.
Mother loved Jesus Christ and always taught us to love him. But she had some questions when she was growing up, because when I was younger and I was asking about some things, my father said, "Of course you believe. I've always known there was a God, and I've always known that Jesus was the Christ, and I've never doubted that Joseph Smith was a prophet." But Mom took me aside later and said, "I haven't always known those things, Terry, and it's okay for you to work through this as I did."
With very little means, they were able to create a lot of fun for our family. We didn't have a lot, but we did have a lot of fun. And I've looked back on what we did that felt so fun. My childhood was so happy. And I've wondered, what is it that they did? And I think it was that both of them had a little bit of magic to make the everyday things special. And Dad would make us laugh, and Mom would fill our tummies with yummy things, and She believed in us. They both really believed in all of their children and had big dreams for us, and we believed them.
But to think that they had 13 children and they made each one of us feel special. I mean, the 11th child. You know, by the time I came around, there were a lot of, you know, there were a lot ahead of me. My parents actually told me that they loved me almost every day. And so I knew they loved me. And, you know, sometimes when you're vulnerable, when you're a young child or a teenager going through difficult years, you need to hear that many, many, many times, and even as an adult.
My parents were very united, even though they're quite different in their approach to things. That gave me a lot of comfort as a child, because we could never go to one and say, oh, but Dad said that I could go to this party. That didn't happen.
My father was gone a lot, which meant that really my mother served in some ways as both a mother and father to me in terms of the amount of time she spent. I was playing baseball and I was a pitcher, and I didn't have a dad to throw the ball back and forth to, and so my mom is the one that was catcher when I was trying to work out becoming a pitcher for my little league team. It was a reflection to me, not about anything negative about my father. It was his reality. He just wasn't around much, but my mom just jumped in and joined right in with me in that phase of my life.
Well, I think my parents in some ways come from almost a different generation. It feels like they're like they lived before the flood, like Abraham. I once wrote a little quatrain for them about that. They seem like they lived, there were giants in the land, it says in the Bible, and I feel like that about my parents. And who could have done that many loads of laundry? Who could have taken that many children and had their first day of kindergarten? Who could have done it? It just seems almost unbelievable, although I lived through it.
You know, it would have been easy after 12 other children to give up and say, you know what, this is the last one, I can do a lot more things. But she didn't not just give up, she just didn't stop being a mother. She was always there. I would come home from school in the big house, and I just yell, Mom, I'm home. And if I just heard her voice say, okay, honey, I didn't have to see her. But it would have been very easy to be a latchkey kid. And, you know, maybe she could have got a job or whatever. But that was the essence of parenting. They saw the parenting role all the way through.
I always felt that I was my father's favorite child. But I know that others of my siblings feel the same way. For whatever reason, he was able to relate to me in a way that made me feel valued and loved. He was the one that typed my papers. He was the one that I went to with problems.
I think the best piece of advice I ever got from my dad was him saying, get the Holy Ghost and then do what it tells you. I think that was something I've thought about a lot in my life, because that really is a wonderful piece of advice. I actually think there were a couple times in my life that I was kept from making bad decisions or doing bad things. I really think it was probably because God was answering my mom's prayers. I think she was probably on her knees praying, and God was, I don't think it was because I was such a good or great person. I think she loved her and blessed me.
She was always giving, always doing service, always very organized, and she'd do quilts. There wasn't anything she couldn't do. I don't know, she was amazing. I don't know how she did it.
One thing that's really amazing to me is that she still connects really, really well with little children. I took one of my sons that's here, hasn't been here for a long time, with his very young children the other day, and she just, every time they'd write a little thing for them or draw a little picture for her on the paper, she'd just say, oh, thank you, great, that's so wonderful. And they just connected with her immediately, and she did with them. She's much better as a great-grandmother doing that than I really am as a grandmother.
Both Mom and Dad had such remarkably good health that we took it for granted for many years that they would live forever. It was quite a shock to us when Mom and Dad were driving down from their home in Holiday to Provo to see our niece, Athelia Graham, play soccer.
as he was driving Mom down. Dad passed out and had taken himself immediately to the hospital. My brothers were called out of the grandstands to go, and I went immediately because I knew something was wrong. While he was there, we found out that he had lung cancer, and he was later given about 3 months to live. But blessedly, he lived for almost 2 years. And during that time, he had a chance to say goodbye to all of his friends, all of his children and grandchildren. Everyone rallied around him and Mom. They had a Tanner teen reunion the weekend before Dad died. And the Tanner teens, all of Mom's grandchildren who were teenagers, helped her move into a new house right before Dad died, and she didn't ever have to spend a night in the house that she had lived in with Dad for those years in Holiday. Our father died on September 1st, 2002.
He did care about success. He cared about our achievements. He wanted us to be the best. But at the fundamental level, what both my mom and my dad cared most about was the gospel, and was exaltation, and was being right with God. So what came to him was a sentence, and others may have told you this, it's now etched on his tombstone, and it says, "In God's divine plan, all achievements will fade into oblivion except personal righteousness."
We all remember my father's funeral, where everyone stood and recited Dad's famous quote.
It has a kind of a lapidary quality, which means the kinds of words that can be etched into stone. And that was etched onto our hearts, my heart at least.
One thing, I had a really good husband that dearly loved me as well as that he dearly loved the gospel. And with that, you can't miss, you know? He wrote me little notes and letters, and he was very kind to me. And if he hadn't been, I wouldn't have been with him. Because we thought a lot of each other, we respected each other a lot. And I miss him more all the time. He was a good man.
Mom served 5 missions, 4 with our father, and 1 with her younger sister, Aunt Lou. Mom is 95 years old at the time of this recording. She's been without her beloved husband for 14 years. And we don't know how much longer we'll have her with us. But we do know that she's impacted our lives and the lives of many, many others through the righteous choices that she consistently makes. Even now, she chooses every day to be happy and positive and loving.
Loved us no matter what, and they cared most about us being faithful and true and good and right before God.
brother John maintains that he never learned anything in a church gospel doctrine class or in any other scripture study experience that he hadn't already learned at the knees of my mother and father.
I just really know that Jesus is truly the Son of God. And I never doubted that, I don't think. And I tried to teach all of you that Jesus Christ was truly the Son of God. It wasn't just a little thing you read about at all. And I try to teach you to be like him.